There's no need in standing up for the right unless you're gonna stand up against the wrong. Tell me how you're gonna ever stop of being weak unless you make your mind up to be strong.
Well, you got to do right, 'cause it won't be long.
It won't be long.
Now let me tell you that it's easy
to hate your enemies, and it's just as easy to love your friends. Tell me you will have to love alike. The Bible tells you you got to let the love of God come in.
Well, you got to do right, 'cause it won't be long.
It won't be long. Don't you wanna love him better? Don't you wanna love him more? Can't you hear the Savior's knocking? He's a knocking at your door.
Don't you wanna make
haste to meet your Maker before you got to deal with the Undertaker? He will take you right now if you are willing. Don't you know the Bible is fulfilling?
You got to do right, 'cause it won't be long.
It won't be long.
You got to do right.
Oh, live a lie, 'cause it won't be long.
It won't be long.
You got to do right. Go live a life.
You got to do right. Go live a life. You got to do right. Go live a life. You got to do right. Go live a life. You got to do right. Go live a life. You got to do right.
So good afternoon, everyone, again. Happy Sabbath. So on this very time, we would like to invite all the youth to come in the front. Please, I would like invite all the youth, if you can, to come in the front. We'll be offered a prayer. So my brothers here with me, each of them, they will be offering a prayer. But on this very moment, we would like to start with the youth. Please, we would like, I'm requesting all the youth to come in the front as we pray for you. Those who feel that if you are sitting there and you feel you are a youth, please come and join us as we pray for you. So don't worry, if you don't do part of this group, there will come another group. So don't worry. So, but right now we'll be praying for the youth. So, if you can, please kneel with me as we seek the Lord in prayer. Father in heaven, Almighty God, thank you so much for who you are. Thank you so much for what you have done in our life. Thank you so much for this opportunity and the privilege that you've given us to come to you to seek thy face, O Lord, in prayer. And Father, before thee is your children, O Lord. I don't know the struggle in their life. I don't know the need in their life, but you know, O Lord. And I don't know what stopped them to seek you, O Lord, to surrender all their life to you. Oh Lord, the harvest is plenty, Lord. And I believe there is much to be done, oh Lord. And I know that everybody cannot preach, but everybody can do something, oh Lord. No matter how great or small, we need to do something for your glory. You came down to die for us, and you didn't think twice to come and to save us. And you are requiring each one of us to stand for you for what is right, oh Lord. Oh Father, please, on this very moment, I would like to pray for my brother and sister here, oh Lord. Oh Father, please, bless them, oh Lord. Maybe someone have fighting, with, oh Lord, with a decision in his or her life, oh Lord. Maybe someone here have feeling that the Lord have calling him or her, oh Lord, but we have doubting, oh Lord, about your voice, thinking if you will provide or not, oh Lord. And maybe something, oh Lord, or sickness have stopped us to reach out, oh Lord. But at this very moment, oh Lord, we come to call upon the name of the Lord, because we believe that nothing is impossible for you, Lord. Please listen to our cry, Lord. I commit each one of us in thy hand. I pray that this afternoon will be not in vain. I pray that this afternoon will be fruitful only for your glory. This we pray and ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Now we are calling the married couples to come in front, and we will be having a special prayer for you. For all the married couples, may you please come in front. Yeah, even if your partner is not here, please come in front. We will have a special prayer for you. Those who are married, blessed with a spouse. If you are not yet married, please don't come. Yeah, please let us fill this space. For those in their seats, may I request reverence as we come before our Lord. Those who are able to kneel, please kneel with us again. Let's pray. Great God, our Heavenly Father, we thank you for this great honor of talking with you. Father in heaven, you have given us so much, yet we have given so little. Father, here are your children. You have called them, O Lord. You have brought them together to each other. You have made them one on the basis of the blood of your Son. Father, in this moment, maybe some of them are not in good terms. Some of them have been fighting, O Lord. Oh, Father, I pray that you will speak to them and you will say to them that they are fighting the wrong enemy. They shouldn't fight with themselves, but, oh, Lord, the enemy is sin. Father, maybe some of them are worrying about their bills in their house, for the education of their children, for their needs. Father, you have said that if we seek first thy kingdom, everything will be added unto us. And also, Lord, we claim in faith and obedience that you will bless us and we will cling to you, because if we have Jesus, we have everything we need. Our Father, maybe some of them are not interested in your word anymore. Father, I pray that you will bind Satan, in the name of your Son, please speak to them, Father. Please draw them closer to you. And possess them, O Lord, and live their lives so that they may follow your commandments in accordance to your will. O Lord, I pray for unity between them. Please unite them as you and your Son are one. For in this unity, everyone who will see them will see Jesus in their lives, and they will be living testimonies, Father, especially in their household. As their children sees them, the children will know that Jesus lives and Jesus saves. Oh, Father, I pray that their sphere of influence will grow larger and larger in accordance to your will. That people will be affected, people will be influenced, people will know that there is a people, that there is a couple that loves Jesus more than they love each other. Father, I pray for these couples, O Lord. You have made them one, and please continue to do so until you come, in Jesus' name. Amen.
For this time, we are inviting all the church elders to come in front as we pray. Church elders, once again, church elders to come up in front as we pray. Can you come a little bit closer? Yes. Church elders, please come in front. Okay, once again, I will invite you to please kneel with me as we pray unto the Lord. Let us pray. Our dear Heavenly Father, we want to thank you once again for this Sabbath that you have given us. It is a great privilege, O Lord, you have given unto us to be together, this fellowship. We thank you, O Lord, for the Sabbath day. It strengthened our relationships, not only with you, but with our brothers and sisters. Our dear Heavenly Father, in your throne of grace, we come, not on our names, but we come in the name of Jesus Christ, the one who died, the one who was resurrected by your voice, the one that is interceding for us. I pray, Father, believing that you are listening and you will answer our prayer, because we pray by faith. Our Father in heaven, we want to be thankful to you because you have given us people who can direct our path here on our churches. We are so thankful to you, Father, for the elders you have given us. Though they have many challenges in their lives, but they've tried their best to lead people to Jesus. Our God in heaven, I pray especially for these last days. It's not been easy. Maybe some of them are tempted, O Lord, to not pray anymore, not study your word anymore. So I pray that the Holy Spirit may come upon them. May you bless their lives, O Lord, as they continue leading your church, as they continue leading the youth. May they be an example for us, O Lord. I pray, Father, any temptation that comes on their way, that the Holy Spirit may come and may help them to be focused only in Jesus Christ and nothing else. Our Father in heaven, as you have promised us in the book of Romans, that in all these things we are more than conquerors. They will face many trials, many temptations, many difficulties, but they will have the victory, because the victory comes from Jesus Christ. Father God in heaven, yet we are doing your ministry. There is always somehow an excuse that we have given. Sin that is inside of our hearts and our minds have separated us from you, Father. Not only from you, but the sin has separated also from our brothers and sisters. So I pray that the elders, as they conduct your church, as they be used by the Holy Spirit, may they give their best to the Lord so that many people, thousands of people, may come to repentance, and may they give their lives through their works. Bless them again, O Lord, because I pray in Jesus' name that their lives will not be the same, because you have blessed them. All these things we ask and we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
This is the time when we will call all the pastors to please to come in front so that we'll offer the last prayer. All pastors. Pastor. Please come, pastors, and we'll pray. All right. We may kneel also. Whoever can kneel with us. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we humbly come to you by faith and recognizing that whoever asks, believing, shall receive. We'd like to dedicate and give these four pastors to you. Heavenly Father, may you please humble them and forgive all their sins. In the name of Jesus, we plead that you will empty them from themselves. As the Bible says, Heavenly Father, they have a great responsibility. To some much is given, and to some less. But to he who much is given, much is required. Heavenly Father, we plead that as they have the burden of taking care of the sheep as shepherds, may they focus their eyes in Jesus, who was the great shepherd ever. Heavenly Father, as the Bible says, when the shepherd dies, the sheep are scattered. Heavenly Father, if there is any pastor who is right now dead in the depth of sin, Heavenly Father, we plead that you will help him to live again and to take the life that Jesus Christ has to offer. Heavenly Father, such a way that the shepherds will have direction and they will look to Jesus also, that the sheep will have somewhere to look and they will not be without direction. And we also plead, Heavenly Father, that if they are going to die as shepherds, may you help them to die to self, such a way that the church will, as they have them as a model, they will keep on growing. Heavenly Father, we plead that you will put your word in their mouth, that whenever they speak to the congregation, wherever they go, the congregation will be hearing the voice of God and not their own ideas and theories. Heavenly Father, may they speak the truth, and may people, Heavenly Father, get to be free because of that truth that only comes from you. We plead that the Holy Spirit will be upon all of them, that they will, Heavenly Father, bear fruit such a way that many will want to also bear fruit and to get closer to Jesus. Heavenly Father, we plead that as the burden is strong, we know that you are also revealing yourself in their life. We plead for their wife, if they are married, in order for you to, Heavenly Father, give them the spiritual strength for them to encourage their husbands. Heavenly Father, we plead also for the kids as they are growing up, Heavenly Father, may they see in their fathers a type of Jesus that they can grow in all the way possible in order for you to be completely glorified. It is in the name of Jesus Christ that we are praying this. May you, as you bless the pastors, may you also bless all the congregations where they are working, and may you use them mightily for your glory. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
We want to continue to praise God for whatever He is doing in our lives. I want to just give you a challenge very humbly. About 4 months or 3 months ago, I rang up to the CLC president, Pastor Ben Casimiro, and said, Pastor, we would like to reach the city of Tagaytay. And will you be happy and willing to speak for an evangelistic series in Tagaytay? He said, that's my passion, that's my call. We praise God that he consented as an administrator. But as a student of evangelism, I know you cannot really go and start doing evangelism like that. You need to have something called sowing. You need to plow the field. You need to do thorough groundwork. And so what we did was we started sending some of our students. I started getting our contact. I can never forget Pastor Lee Calatrava. Shall we say amen to him? Amen. I am so humbled to see a pastor like him. The way that man worked so hard, I really praise God. But at the right time, God has brought another pastor. Thank you, Pastor Ray. God brings in his own timing. So what we did was we started sending some students to different churches to till the land, to see how the ground reality is. But God was so good to us that he helped us to be exposed to this climate. And we started mingling with them. But the most important thing is that you not only have to have a preacher, you need to have finances. And it costs a lot of money. Especially Tagaytay is a very rich culturally heritage city. And this city is known for tourism and development. And so it happens to be very prime. So there are a group of dedicated members from Pasay Church who have really come forward willingly to help see the program. I want to tell you what we have in our mind. Friends, you might be thinking, why are we gathering here? From seven churches, we are gathered here less than 436 people. Shall we say amen? Amen. And we gave a call, why have you come here? To be involved as members of the Adventist Church, to gospelize, to evangelize, to be partakers of God's divine commission. Do you know how many people have sacrificed that you could come here? In just a short while, you will have a very, very pleasant and a delicious drink. You see here, you're enjoying the AC. Somebody has paid. Many students had to be brought. Somebody paid their transportation. People are doing their best, and we would like to have a special request. And I want all of you to listen to me carefully. There is a challenge. Please listen to me carefully. I want all of you to pray for us. We wanted to do 9 days evangelism right here. Somebody promised that they will help us. It's not about finance. But this is so busy, we are not getting 9 days continuously. Are you getting what I'm saying? You can take for 3 days, and then there is 2 days function. And then again, we are available for 3 days. We cannot have an evangelism like that. So we are hoping to have something at the end of this year. So I am praying that God will really intervene. Will you all please pray? Please pray that some of them will cancel their appointments. Some of them will postpone their weddings. They don't have to be married this year necessarily, you know. Maybe after 1 year they can be married, you know. Let's pray. You never know. Yeah, since I'm married, I'm very happy. Okay, let's pray. I want you to pray that God will somehow make it possible. Because the availability of our pastor, he has given me 2 successive weeks. I'm not able to fit. I've been coming here almost 9 times. I'm trying to plead with them, but we are having a challenge. The reason why we would love to have is this. This is very affordable and economic, and it lies within the budget. And this is also the center, like the epicenter of all the 7 churches. So I have a special request. So I'm going to request all of you to kneel down right now, 2 by 2, 2 by 2, and pray that God, in his own providence and time, will make time and provision for us that we will have the 9 days of meeting right here in Summit Ridge. And let's pray. I don't know how it will happen, when it will happen. Let's pray that God will give us conducive atmosphere and timing and schedule. Okay? 2 by 2, 2 by 2. Pray earnestly. Okay, there is a very special announcement. All the children, will you please get up? We are going to have a separate session for you because we have two important presentations here. One by a lay dental student. You will see how to be involved, and then we will hear the final charge and commitment by the CLC president. We want to get serious with this timing. Children, get up. We are having a separate session for you. Children, you are not sure who the children are. I will tell you who are the children. 12 years and below. If you are not a teen, 13. If you are 12 years and below. Will you please get up? Please get up. Monisha, please come here. I want all of you to come here and follow this auntie, okay? Okay, let's go. Just take them. Okay, just go at the back. Okay, just follow her. Okay, just go. Leave them at the back. Okay, children, we don't want you to be here during these presentations because these are meant. Okay, quickly. Thank you so much. Let us get serious. I have another request. For the next two presentations, I want all of you to lend your careful ears because God is going to use. Want to welcome in a very special way. He is a final year dental student. He is just a few weeks away to graduate, maximum about 3 or 4 weeks. But I want you to listen to see how, not just theology students, how God uses dentistry students. Shall we say amen? Praise God. Brother Ronald Robin, this is your time. Thank you, sir. Do you want me to bring the pulpit down?
Let us all pray as we begin. Divine Father, we want to thank you for allowing us to be in your holy presence. We thank you because this is your day. This is special because it is the Sabbath day. We thank you for allowing us to be in your divine, revered, powerful presence. Lord, we dare not step forward without pleading for your presence in our midst. We want to thank you, God, for how far you have brought us in the less we have sought of you. And yet your grace and mercy is so abundant that we are still alive. We have not been consumed. Oh, Father, we praise you. The Bible tells us it is solely because of your mercies that this day is possible. I thank you, O God, for giving us this privilege to study a special, special subject of understanding. And as brothers and sisters, we gather together. Lord, may this not be a vain experience. I pray that this may be a Holy Spirit-inspired experience. Please, O God, bless us as we study your word. We plead that your Holy Spirit would make this word true, personal, and real to us. Guide us, Lord, please. We are lost, do not know what we're doing. Even in our homes, our families, our churches, they're falling apart, please. Please hold us together and show us now, O God, what it means to be children of God in these last days. Teach us now, dear Father, And let everyone go from here a changed, mission-driven Christian. Help us, Father. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Happy Sabbath, everyone. I'd like to turn your attention to the book of Judges, chapter 2. Judges, chapter 2. The book of Judges is a powerful study to undertake, and some friends of ours, we've been studying this book very closely and have been enjoying it. We want to take some time to take a look at a few verses here. Judges chapter 2 and verse 8, the Bible says, Joshua the son of Nun, the servant of the Lord, died, being 110 years old. Joshua, who's taken the banner from Moses, and as he moves forward in this journey, the Bible says he dies when he was 110 years old. Verse 9 says, they buried him in the border of his inheritance in Timnath-Heres, in the mount of Ephraim on the north side of the hill Gaash. Verse 10, and all that generation were gathered unto their fathers, and there arose another generation after them which knew not the Lord, nor yet the works which he had done for Israel. The Bible says when Joshua died, they raised another generation to Israel, and this next generation that came into existence, they did not know the Lord. The Bible said they did not know the Lord, neither did they know the works which he had done for Israel. And the moment you read this, you're asking yourself, how did they go from Moses crossing the Red Sea and deliverance from years, over 400 years of Egyptian bondage, how did they come out of all that and then end up raising a generation, raising up children that knew nothing about God? God's people, who saw food drop down from heaven for 40 years. They raised up children who knew nothing about God. A generation rose up, the Bible says, that knew not the Lord. You've got to be careful. Verse 7 tells us, before talking about all this, verse 7 earlier on in their introduction says, these people served the Lord how many days? How many days? All the days. These elders, these church members, these Seventh-day Adventists, they served the Lord all their days. All the days of the elders that outlived Joshua, who had seen all the great works of the Lord that he did for Israel. So they were in church on the Sabbath day. They were faithful tithe payers. They were very obedient in church attendance. They came to church and engaged in many evangelistic activities and came for prayer and fastings. But the Bible says they raised up children that did not know the Lord. Our subject is mission driven homes. One of the greatest diseases of the church is we've been preaching from pulpits and asking people, get out and get the work done. Engage in evangelistic activities. Go and tell this and that. But we've forgotten the sacred responsibility of what it means to have mission-driven churches which actually start from mission-driven homes. Homes that are not mission-oriented and mission-minded are homes that have no interest in mission when they come to the church. See, I don't get it. The Bible says they raised up a generation that did not know the Lord. How did you eat food for free for 40 years and never tell your children? How do you deliverance from Egyptian bondage? How do you go through that and never live to tell your children, this is what God did for us. This is how he delivered. In one night, he took us out. How do they see the Red Sea part? The Egyptian army drowned and never tell. Why is it that somebody is not sharing a testimony of how down they were in their finances and how the Lord saw them through to encourage some other young person who is going through a similar trouble? Now we're quick to blame the youth and say the youth are leaving the church. The youth are doing this and the youth are doing that. Oh, they do drugs and oh, they do this and that. But I don't blame them. The Bible says they didn't live to see manna drop from heaven. This generation was not alive when the Red Sea was parted. This generation was not there when they were delivered from Egyptian bondage. They were not there. What went missing? I believe the generation that experienced all this did not teach. The generation that experienced all these miracles of God did not teach the next generation. Now God was intentional. As he brings them out of the wilderness, Moses is asked to pen down the beautiful words in the book of Deuteronomy. The book of Deuteronomy is written 40 years after the wilderness. As they enter Canaan, Moses is penning these words down and writing down their experience in the wilderness. And notice what he says in Deuteronomy 6, God speaking. These words which I command thee this day shall be in thine heart. Deuteronomy 6 verse 7, the Bible says, you will teach them diligently. How? You will teach them diligently unto thy children. And when will you teach them? You will what? Talk to them when they sit. When you walk. When you lie down. When you rise up. In other words, no matter what you're doing, your life should be a teaching testimony to your children. Mission-driven homes. You ask Israel, and you look at them with contempt and despair, and they say, what kind of people were these that never taught? But before you point at them, there's a mirror staring at you when you look at the children of Israel. There's a mirror staring back at you when you look at the children of Israel, because my question this evening is, what are you teaching your children? What are you teaching your children? And I'm not saying we're not having morning worships and evening worships. No. What's happening between the morning and evening worships? What are you really imparting to the children at home? And something, no, because we've been going through the Bible stories and because we've been singing and doing all this good work, children get it. Israel read their Bibles. Israel went to the scripture. Israel had memorized scripture. That wasn't the problem. Somebody did not teach. It's strange though, because when we talk about teaching, we immediately picture a chalkboard or a PowerPoint slide and a person standing up to preach. That's not always teaching. Some of the finest teachings have been imparted to people by the way people live, not by what they say. And if you've been a parent long enough, you know that what you say will fail you, but what you do has a greater impact on your children. I want to talk, not for too long, just for a few moments, to parents, mothers, fathers, and then the youth for a while. What it means to have mission-oriented, mission-minded, mission-driven homes. Take a look at this. Adventist Home, page 20, paragraph 1. the first work to be done in a Christian home is to see that the Spirit of Christ abides there. That when you enter home from work, you feel like you're entering an atmosphere of Christ. But do you know there are people who are afraid to come back home in the evening? Are you there? You don't have to admit it because you're sitting next to your spouse. You don't have to admit it, but there are spouses who are afraid to come back home in the evening because of the torture they go through emotionally at home. The first Christian work to be done, the first work to be done in a Christian home is to see that the Spirit of Christ abides there. That every member of the household may be able to take his cross and follow where Jesus leads the way. And we think, no, we're still having worships. We bring our kids to Sabbath school. We impart them good teachings. We give them food and we provide their needs. And we think we're teaching them good stuff doing that. But just pay attention. When there is disagreement between who? Between who? Why is it that I don't hear fathers and mothers speak out loud? When there is disagreement between who? Father and mother. The children partake of the? But no, we're quick to look at the child. Hey, you stop fighting. You're always fighting. Why are you always fighting? But they never asked, why do we always fight as spouses? Am I really talking to someone? Or this is new to you. You've never experienced fightings at home. When the mother and father, in fact, Sister White says, the atmosphere of the home is dependent on the parents. The life they live individually, they carry the same atmosphere and bring it into their homes, and the children partake of the same atmosphere. So if the father enters home with his greed, with his lust, with his flesh-filled passions, the children partake of the same experience. But you think, no, sending them to Sabbath school will make them good kids. Oh, but we had morning devotion and we have evening devotion. That should have done its job. This is tough, the next one. The home should be, to the children, the most attractive place in the world. Can your children say that about your home? Can children really say that about their homes? It is the most attractive place in the world to me, being there with mother and father. Wow. Unless children can be trained and disciplined from their babyhood by a wise and judicious mother who is conscientious and intelligent, and who rules her household in the fear of the Lord, molding and shaping their character to meet the standard of righteousness. It is a what? No. It is a what? It is a sin to increase your... One more time then. Unless you train your children and discipline them from their childhood to make them wise, and in fact ruled by a wise and judicious mother who is conscientious, intelligent, rules her household in the fear of the Lord, molding and shaping their characters to meet the standard of righteousness. It is a sin. Which simply means it's a sin to have children. Are you still listening in the back? If as parents, you saw your own self struggling and low with God and not right with God and not strong with God, and you knew that this is going to carry on when I have a child, and it's strange, people say, no, when you have a child, you'll be fine. No, you won't be. So these are strong words then, that if a person in that spiritual condition thinks that he can have more children, he's committing a sin.
Wow.
Children should be taught that they are only what? Probationers here and educated to become inhabitants of the mansions which Christ is preparing for those who love him and keep his commandments. This is the highest duty which parents have to perform. The highest duty, above giving your children food, clothing, shelter, schooling, education, comfort, a bed to sleep on, the highest duty as parents is to teach your children that this world is not our home. This world is not our home. But if parents are constantly, unceasingly exposing the children to the world. I see why there is so much of a silence here tonight, this evening. If parents are constantly exposing their children to the world, how do you teach them this world is not my home? When they see the avarice, the greed, the flesh-filled passion of the father and mother, how do you expect your children to be selfless and Christ-like? It's interesting, a recent survey done amongst youth to study why are the youth leaving the church. Are you still listening? Why are the youth leaving the church? What's the problem? Why is it that our youth are leaving the church? They're taking up jobs on the Sabbath. They're getting married to people outside the faith. They're leaving our faith, joining other faiths. Why are the youth leaving the church? Do you know what's the number one reason? And we like to come up with these different styles. No, you know, our music is boring and our programs are not interesting. The number one reason they gave was parents. Number one reason given by youth, not by adults, youth gave the reason. The number one reason why we leave the church is because of our own parents. I'll tell you why. These youth, Sabbath morning, it's time to go to church. Youth are at home, young people getting ready for church, and the father, who happens to be an elder at the church or a regular church member, he's there in the early Sabbath morning, and he's shouting at the top of his voice. He's angry. You've got to go. Get out. We're late for church. Why are you not ready? So he's shouting, fighting with the wife. You're not there yet. And he's so angry. Rushes everyone in the car. So everyone in the car, now they're driving to church. As they're driving to church, the mother begins to talk. Who is she talking about? She's talking about one of the ladies in church. The deaconess, probably. That deaconess? We're going to church? You just see the kind of dress she wears. She doesn't even know how to dress in church. That deaconess. Oh. They hear the father talk. Children, young children, they're listening to the father talk. What does that pastor think of himself? That elder knows nothing. He thinks he's too small. I could do a better job. So they hear all these things from the parents. But when they get out of the car, park the car and enter church, the same father, with that loud, angry tone, talking down about that elder, enters church and says, "Elder, happy Sabbath." Elder. Oh. The mother who was talking about the deaconess, she goes to that same deaconess who she said does not know how to dress. She goes to her, shakes hand and says, "Sister, you look so beautiful today." Am I talking to someone or... You know what the youth said? If Adventism is this much filled with hypocrisy, we don't want Adventism. If being a Seventh Adventist means to do this, we don't want to be a part of this church. We'd rather stay at home. If they're going to talk like this bad about people, call them names. Are you listening? Call them names, talk down to them, label them, If this is what they do behind them, and when they see them, they act as if they're angels with wings behind them. We don't want this kind of faith. Got a question for you. What are you really teaching your children? What are the children really learning? The tone of voice during worship is very pleasant, but what happens to that tone of voice during the rest of the day? And Sister White says, when you get angry at your child because they misbehave, don't really get angry. Don't be too harsh on them because you're really looking at yourself in the child. Are you still there? So you look at the child and say, nah, my child, so short-tempered. You're looking at yourself. So what kind of atmospheres are going on in our own homes? Our work for Christ is to begin with the family. In the home, there is no missionary field more important than. So what's the greatest mission field? Home. Are you still alive? What's the greatest mission field? And yet somebody wants to go to Africa. Are you there? And it's strange, whenever we talk about mission trips, has to be Africa, as if that's the only place that needs Christ. Brothers and sisters, you've got to listen very carefully. We're working the equation the wrong way. And we think we're so smart that we can cheat our children into thinking that this is what it means to be a Christian. They can see through you. They can see through you and see when you're pretending. This is serious. So our evangelistic work does not start from pulpits. It starts from the family altar at home. It starts in the responsibilities of a father and a mother at home. And that's really something that's missing. Let me talk to the youth in just one statement. The highest duty that devolves upon youth is in their. The highest duty of the youth is where? In their own homes. See, many young people, I'll talk to you for just one second. Many young people have given up on their homes. Are you there? You've given up. Nah, my father always like this. Ah, my mother always talks rude to me. Ah, there's no hope here. The prophet of the Lord says, your highest duty as a young person is to minister to your own family, be a blessing to father, mother, brother, sisters by affection and true interest. So if you think, young people, you think your parents are ungodly, then bring God in your own home before you start judging your parents. Before you start looking down on them, if you think God is missing, you be the one to plead for God to be in your homes. The youth has a serious work to do. Listen to this, friends. This is my last statement before I sit. Why is it that there is such a lack of missionary spirit in our churches? Answer, it is because there is a neglect of home piety. Are you there? Not because there are not many people emphasizing mission work. Not because many people are not preaching more about going out and doing the work of God. No. That's not the reason. The truth is, we no longer have holy homes. There is no holiness, piety, holiness. Where holiness is lacking in our homes, their children, mother, father, are growing up to be missionless people, coming to missionless churches, raising up missionless children. I've got a question again for you. What are you really teaching? What are you really teaching? What are you really teaching your sons and daughters, your spouses, your friends, your neighbors, your co-workers. And many have given up. Some have decided, no, spiritual responsibilities, only mother has to do. Father has got nothing to do with this. Are you still there? Some ladies speak up. Some fathers have decided, spiritual self, go talk to your mom, don't talk to me. The Bible tells us, the prophet of the Lord is appealing to us. Home is a unit, and we are to work together to raise up godly children, to raise up godly homes, to raise up mission-minded families in the Lord. My time is up. I want to end with a prayer, but I want to ask, if you're here with your family, can you stand with your family right now? If you're here with your family, can you stand together as a family? If you're here with your family, can you stand with your family? Even if you're seated apart, please do not sit apart. If you're here with your family, can you just stand as a family, wherever you are? Wherever you may be, if you're here with your family, can you just stand with your family? Brother, sister, mother, child, whoever is here, as long as you have a family member next to you, just, if they're here in this room, go to them. Don't sit far away from them. If you're here with your family, can you just stand with them? I want you to form a circle. If you're more than two, can you just form a small circle? We're going to have a prayer time now. And we're going to specifically pray for families. And I want you to spend some time in prayer. We'll give you about 3 minutes to pray together as a family. And I want you to specifically pray for that which is missing in the home, where you're lacking, where you need to grow, that which is missing, piety that has gone out of the homes, Christ that has gone missing, children who want to enter mission fields but you're discouraging them from doing so. Am I still talking to someone? Children who want to enter mission fields but you're telling them there is no money there, you're telling them there is no future there. If you're that parent, you need Christ this evening. And so if you're with your family, if you can form a circle, or if you can just be close to each other, we'll give you about 3 minutes to pray as a family. No pretense, don't sound grammatically correct. Plead unto the Lord. Nobody knows better than you, as a core team of a family, what the need of the family really is. Would you just take some time to pray with each other? Right now, the youth who are seating, other those who are not with your family, pray for your families right now. Pray for your families right now. So wherever you are, this is a time of serious prayer and serious uplifting your hearts and your families to the Lord. So please, take this time. We're going to give you about 3 minutes to pray for your families. Dear Father in heaven, we thank you. We thank you for your long suffering towards us. We thank you for we have not made it our first work to see to it, to check, to assess, and see if the Spirit of Christ abides in our homes. Dear Father, we ask for forgiveness, for giving up on family members. And thank you for teaching us that a lack of holiness at home has resulted in the lack of missionary work. Lord, there is no total member involvement today because there has been no total holiness in our homes. And Father, we will keep on struggling. We will keep on meeting for prayer and fasting one after another and still come back to the next one, the same person. If we do not decide now, dear God, to uplift Jesus in our homes, not just by what we say. Oh Lord, forgive us, for we forget the word of anger we speak and the children listen and learn. For the hatred we exhibit and the children learn and do the same. Father, have mercy. Have mercy on us. Have mercy on your people. Lord, have mercy on mothers and fathers who have brought into their homes the curse of the evil one, who have brought into their homes the greed, the hatred, the malice, the anger. And the children have taken part of that, Lord. In the book of Hebrews, you remind us that one day they will have to give an account for what they did to their children. Oh, great Master, have mercy on mothers and fathers this evening. Father, I plead for your hand of love also to rest upon the youth. We who have given up on loved ones, we who have not prayed and fasted for our homes, and where Jesus was missing, we just placed the final word and did not plead for Jesus to come in. Father, forgive us. Forgive us, we pray. Lord, we need Jesus in our homes. Jesus, the true missionary, is the only one, Lord, who can get every member of the home involved first before we will see a total membership involvement. Please, Father, hear our cry, we plead. These families that are standing, other families that are represented here, whether in this country or in any other country in this world, we humbly pray, Lord, that you may save these homes. We pray that you may rescue these homes. We pray that you may snatch these homes out of the hands of the evil one. Oh Lord, put fear in the hearts of the parents, God-ordained fear, that they will tremble at the thought of how to raise their children. They will not feel self-sufficient, but Lord, make them to seek you in knowing how to discipline the children. Teach them Christ-likeness. Teach them, Lord, how to behave in the presence of the Lord. Father, please bless your people this evening. Prepare us as we get ready for a commitment message. As this evening ends, Lord, we want to go home only with Jesus. Save us, Father. Save us. We thank you. We praise you. We give you glory, Lord. For it is your promise that when you say the word, it will not go back to you unaccomplished. We claim that you will save our homes. We claim, O God, that you will save your loved ones. You will save these families. You will save the children growing in these homes. And that this will be a generation that will know the Lord. We praise you, God, in Jesus' name. Amen.
We continue to praise God. I have a very important announcement to make. Please listen to me carefully, and I solicit your fullest cooperation. We're going to have a break for about 10 minutes, exactly 10 minutes. Then we come back for consecration. there is a small drink available right at the far end. I want all the members' cooperation in this regard. You cannot actually take the drink outside this hall in the hallway. You are kindly requested to drink and place the empty cups right at the rear table, because there are some terms and conditions under which we have been given some concession. We have not hired for banquet hall, but we are giving a small drink. We want your fullest cooperation. We will now depart one by one towards the end. You may kindly, after consuming your drink, place the empty cups right on the glass table. Do not take your drinks outside this hall, please. I want to request, shall we all just go back, have a drink? You can place the empty cups, you can use your restrooms. Exactly in 10 minutes, we will come back. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.